Hello, welcome to Free Bible Commentary with Pastor Teacher Dr. Bob Utley. Be sure to visit Free Bible Commentary at www.freebiblecommentary.org. Now, here's Bob.
We're continuing our study in 2 Kings. Today we're going to be in one of the great revivals, at least externally and in the heart of a godly king. It didn't last. Apparently it was external to most of the people who had been so accustomed to the idolatrous practices of Manasseh and his son. But boy, we've got a good heart here in Josiah. Chapter 22 of 2 Kings tells about how he came to the throne very young, how he found the law in the temple. We think it's probably some part of Deuteronomy. In chapter 23, we start delineating the extent of his reform. It started in the temple. It moved to Jerusalem. It moved to Judah. It moved to even the northern kingdom. Oh, it's a good chapter. A lot of things are happening here historically. The world powers are switching. Assyria is declining. Babylon's on the rise. Egypt is becoming a power again. But in this period, there's been a real fighting among Egypt and Babylon, which debilitated both of them to such an extent that Judah became independent just because the other ones had almost knocked each other out. And in this time, this gap, Josiah came. Now, there was a national resurgence. There was a longing to go back to the good old days. And boy, Josiah, what a king. Then the king sent and gathered to him all the elders of Judah and Jerusalem. Now, elders, usually in the Old Testament, are tribal leaders, but they came to be identified with older people of wisdom and renown in a local area like Jerusalem. And the king went up to the house of the Lord, and all the men of Judah and all the inhabitants of Jerusalem with him, and the priests and the prophets and all the people. Now, priests and prophets are two sources of inspiration or revelation, really. There are three in the Old Testament. There is the priest of the law, which we get from Moses, Leviticus, the Pentateuch, the Torah. Then there is the prophets, where, and you're familiar with that, and to the Hebrews, Kings and Chronicles or prophets, the writers. And then we have all the prophets you're familiar with, the major and minor prophets. There's one more group that's not mentioned here, and that's the sages. And that's the wisdom literature, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, Job, Song of Songs. And so here's two of the groups. Now, I want you to notice that one of these prophets is a lady. I think some of you have an ingrained bias against that. I want you to look right back up in chapter 22, verses 8 through 13, and there is the prophetess Huldah. And boy, she's a good girl, I want to tell you. Now, notice here where it says, both small and great, and he read in their hearing all the words of the Book of the Covenant, which most assume is some part of Deuteronomy. Now, this is not something new. Several times in the Old Testament, the law is written orally. Let me give you a few. Exodus 20, verses 1 and following. Deuteronomy 5, 4 and following. Nehemiah 8, 1. And so it's many occasions where that was read. Now, notice where it says, which was found in the house of the Lord. Now, you've got to go back to chapter 22 to see all this. We don't know exactly what's happening. It's obvious that the reform was already going to some extent before the law was found because the temple was being remodeled. Isn't it amazing that they had lost part of the law of Moses, knowing how much the Jews loved that? Well, what amazes me more is that they had lost it, didn't know they had lost it. They had become so idolatrous for so many years that they had lost that true zeal and love and even the revelation of Yahweh, their ancient tribal God. Now, notice in verse 3, and the king stood by the pillar. Now, we have several references of him standing by the pillar. I think back in chapter 16, 18, he's referring to a special platform, a conspicuous place where the king stood, where all the people could see that the king was participating in worship as they were. A prominent place. You'll see chapter 2 Kings 11, 14, 2 Chronicles 23, 13, Nehemiah 8, 4. Okay. And so he made a covenant before the Lord to walk after the Lord, to keep his commandments, his testimonies, his statutes, with all his heart and all his soul. What he's saying, I'm making a priority commitment to you, O God, to do what you've told us to do. And because he made the commitment, look at the last of verse 3, and all the people entered into the covenant. As Manasseh had seduced them down the road of idolatry, Josiah led them down the road of covenant fidelity and loyalty. Friends, leaders are important people. They really have an influence. Now, look at verse 4. Here we begin the purge of these foreign deities and foreign practices. And I'm sure the Assyrian gods were the first to go. Assyria was losing her power. She couldn't enforce this anymore. They so hated her. It's a cruel nation that when she couldn't reinforce her claim on Judah, man, they started kicking out her gods. They're going to kick out all the gods eventually. They're going to start with the gods of Assyria. Now, and the king commanded Hilkiah, the high priest, and the priest of the second order. Now that means those who serve the sanctuary. They didn't offer the sacrifice. They were the keepers of the door and keepers of this and that. And the doorkeepers to bring out of the temple of the Lord all the vessels that were made for Baal and Asherah. Now I want to show you that same graphic I showed you last week about all of these different deities. Now let's see it if we could. And I want you to notice I've changed one. I've changed divination, witchcraft, to teraphim, which we're going to hit. I've left divination in, even though the word doesn't appear in this chapter. All those same idolatries are going to occur. As those were present in the reign of Manasseh, so they are objects of the purge in Josiah. I've added several at the bottom, and we'll get to those in the middle of this chapter. Those are gods of the nations around Judah, and we'll talk about those, but that's the list. And if you don't have time to do that and you want it, just put your video recorder on pause, and I think you can read those. Now, notice it says Baal and Asherah, Canaanite fertility gods, men and women, all the host of heaven, the Babylonian astral deities, and he burned them outside Jerusalem in the fields of the Kidron and carried their ashes to Bethel. Now, of course, to burn these idols is what Deuteronomy 7:25 says to do with them. And why would he carry the ashes to Bethel? Well, Bethel is the site of the calf worship of the northern 10 tribes. It was already unclean and polluted, so Josiah said, we'll just dump more pollution there. And so he just dumped the ashes of all these idols at the place of Jeroboam the first, golden calf. Now, and he did away with the idolatrous priests whom the kings of Judah had appointed to burn incense in the high places. Now, from verse 20, I think he slit their throat, all of them. Here it doesn't seem like that, but verse 20 says he slaughtered them. Notice it says, the mention of Baal again, to the sun, the moon, the constellations, and all the host of heaven. Now this Babylonian ancient astrology, which is so prominent in our own day in all these horoscopes junk, was the worship of the sun, the moon, the five major planets, and the zodiac. And so here again we have man trying to control his own destiny, run his own ship, and getting away from God, and that's his sample right here. Now, verse 6, and he brought out the Asherah from the house of the Lord outside Jerusalem, the brook Kidron, burned at the brook, ground it in dust, and threw its dust on the graves of the common people. Well, what does that mean? Well, Asherah is supposed to be carved wood, symbol of the female fertility god of the Canaanite pantheon. And he just didn't want to burn it. He wanted to do something with the ashes. Now, when it says he threw them on the graves of the common people, one or two things are here. Either the common people had so participated in the idolatrous practices of the Judean kings that this was a symbol of saying, you love them, you can live with them, and throw them. Or Jews really don't like graveyards. They're considered unclean. And maybe it's kind of like throwing the ashes on Bethel. It was already unclean, so it wouldn't pollute anything. So he may have just put them in the graveyard. Now, look at verse 7. He broke down the house of the male cult prostitutes. Now, what is that? Well, the word here, literally in Hebrew, is the word sacred or holy. But it's a male form of this. And so it came to mean either sodomites, homosexuals, or male prostitutes in the sense of the fertility cult. And we're not real sure which. But, notice it said, which were in the house of the Lord. Male prostitutes in the house of the Lord? Does that seem so incongruent? And notice again it says, where the women were weaving hangings to Asherah. Now probably these were the cultic virgins, and apparently they were making for themselves sensuous garments to dress in and practice their fertility rites. Apparently that's what that is. Then he brought all the priests from the cities of Judah and defiled the high places by throwing dead bones on them and that kind of thing, burning them. And he burned incense from Geba to Beersheba, and he broke down the high places of the gates. Apparently, even in Jerusalem, these high places, these altars to foreign deities, were even the gates of Jerusalem. Now, back in the book of Judges, these high places were to worship Yahweh. But as the nation got away from God, they came to be Canaanite or Phoenician or Babylonian or Assyrian. So all the gods were worshipped here. And that's why God wanted to pull everything into one central sanctuary committed to him. Now, notice, if you would, where it mentions Let's see, verse 10. He also defiled Topheth, which is Hebrew for fire or place of burning, which is in the valley of the sons of Hinnom. Now, this is the term that when Jesus speaks about hell, he talks about Gehenna. Ge is valley, Hinnom, the valley of the sons of Hinnom. This is where the god Molech was worshipped. He's mentioned in the last part of verse 10. He was a Phoenician fire god to which the firstborn child was worshipped, sacrificed. The Jews hated him. Golly, it's unbelievable. Some think that they misunderstood that about the offering of the firstborn. But can you imagine the dedication involved in offering your first child to a fire god? These folks were committed and sincere. They were just sincerely idolatrous. Now, notice in verse 11, the sun god is mentioned. And he did away with the horses which the king of Judah had given to the sun. And notice a little bit further down, it says he burned the chariots of the sun with fire. Apparently, this was given to the sun god, and they were kept right outside the temple area. Now, there's one of two things here. A horse was either sacrificed to the sun, or probably because of the mention of chariot, this is the idea of in these processions to the sun god, the chariot with these beautiful, usually white horses, was ridden as a symbol of the sun going across the sky. Right at the temple entrance. And he burns those horses and those chariots with fire. Now, notice the altars which were on the roof of the upper chamber. These altars and these foreign deities were everywhere in Judah and Jerusalem. Josiah sniffed them out, destroyed every one of them. Now, in verse 13, we have the gods of the nations around. Now, look at what we have. And the high places which were before Jerusalem, which were on the right of the Mount of Destruction, which Solomon, king of Israel, had built. Now, these are the gods, are the altars to gods that Solomon had put up for his foreign wives so they could go to church in their own fashion, if you please. And here they were still there. First is this Ashtoreth. Now that's very close to Ashtaroth, but this is a male form. This is the god Ashtar. We see it in the male singular form in 1 Kings 11, 5 and 33. It's normally female, but here it is male, so it's that god. Now, Chemosh is the male war god of Moabites, or Moab. Notice that Milcom is not synonymous with Molech, though both of them are probably some kind of corruption of the Hebrew word for king, Melech. But we don't know much about Milcom. It's a male god, and it's the god of Ammon, and we see him in several places in the Old Testament. The first two may be related to star worship. We're just not sure. In verse 14, it's mentioned the Ashtoreth again. Now, Ashtoreth in Hebrew, to add an I-M on a word is to make it plural. So, Ashtoreth, plural, Ashtoreth, it's those female consort of the Canaanite fertility gods. Notice they fill their places with human bones. Now, that was to defile them or make them unclean. Notice it says the altar that was at Bethel. This seems to say that Josiah's reformation even included part of the northern 10 tribes. The Second Chronicle says it went way to the north. Here we have it, the purification of Bethel. You might well see Second Chronicles 34, 6 and 7. Let's see now. Let's look at verse 16. Now when Josiah turned, he saw the graves that were on the mountain. Now this seems to be up in Samaria because it mentions a prophet through here who prophesied to Jeroboam the first. Now remember, Jeroboam the first is the one that was the Ephraimite labor leader that caused the northern 10 tribes to rebel against Solomon's son Rehoboam in 922 BC. And so a prophet from Judah went to the north to say, Jeroboam, it's going to be bad. Your bones are going to be burnt and scattered. And you all see 1 Kings 13, 1 and following for that Judean prophet and his message. Now let's go down to verse 21. Then the king commanded all the people, saying, celebrate the Passover. Now, it's not very long here, just three verses, but in 2 Chronicles 35 is an elaborate 19-verse description of all the animals that were sacrificed. And something is said here that's unbelievable to me. Look in verse 22. Surely such a Passover had not been celebrated from the days of the judges who judged Israel, nor in the days of the kings of Israel and of the kings of Judah. You mean that these national feast days had so lapsed, either in significance or totally, that all the period of Samuel and Kings, there was no Passover? Well, either it meant a Passover with this degree of dedication or this degree of remembrance, or it means the Passover was just not done in any significant way all that time. It's amazing to me. Now, let's go down to verse 24. Moreover, Josiah removed the mediums and the spiritists and the teraphim. Now, here are three more of these different kind of occultic practices. Man trying to control his own destiny. Now, the word mediums, as I told you last week, comes from the Hebrew word bottle. Now, it either meant wind blowing over a bottle that made a funny sound. In the Septuagint, it's translated ventriloquist. So it's someone who can control these strange sounds, supposedly from the dead. Now, I've got two views of this. I think there are some people who can communicate with the dead. And I don't think it's of God at all. I also think there's a lot of charlatans and fakes out there, even in the name of witchcraft and the occult. So this is somebody either who really had a familiar spirit and could talk to the dead, or it was a trickster who just wanted to manipulate people and get their money, which it is, I'm not sure. Now, the spiritist, from the Hebrew knowing ones, which seemed to mean someone who was a high-level medium or a high-level communicator with the dead. And then we have this strange little word, the teraphim. Now, these are household gods or idols. We see them several times in the Old Testament. You look at Leviticus 19:31, Leviticus 20:27, and Deuteronomy 18:11. But for the medium and spiritist. But for the teraphim, you ought to see Genesis 31:19, Judges 17:5, and 1 Samuel 19:13. This is what Jacob's wife stole from her daddy, and Laban came after her to get them. They were little shrines that people had in their own homes to worship by. Okay, let's see. Let's skip down to verse 26 if we could. By the way, let me do 25. And before him there was no king like him who turned to the Lord with all his heart, with all his soul, with all his might, according to all the law of Moses, nor did any like him rise after him. Even David got away. Solomon turned in his old age. Hezekiah had some problems. This is the most godly king we know about. And he turned to the Lord with all his heart, with all his mind, with all his soul, from 8 years old to the day he was killed. And he was tragically killed. And I'm going to get into the history in just a minute. But this young king died early, and everybody wonders why. Why? We don't know. Now, verse 26. However, the Lord did not turn from the fierceness of his great wrath, which his anger burned against Judah, because of all the provocations of which Manasseh had provoked him. Josiah had a radical religious reformation, but it did not turn God's heart away. Let me tell you why. Two things. Either Josiah's reform was basically superficial and did not touch the hearts and motives of the people, or Manasseh had gone so far that they passed the point of no return. There is a point of no return in our dealings with God. We can sin away our day of grace, and it can never come again. Now, that's a serious statement, but it's very true. You can say no to God just so much, and then it becomes impossible to say yes. Now, that seems to be the condition that Judah had found herself in, okay? Now, in verse 28, I've got a little historical chart I want to show you, because I need to set the stage for you for what's going to happen at Josiah's death. So let's look at our graphic on the history surrounding this. Let's look this together. Now, number one, Assyria is on the decline. Media and Babylon are the major empires of the Fertile Crescent. Egypt, who has been Assyria's enemy for so long, decides that having Assyria around is better than having a world power like Babylon. So Egypt moves up the Palestinian coast to the headwaters of the Euphrates to try to help the Assyrian army, Ashurbanipal, regroup and take back its capital in Haran. But Egypt is drastically defeated. But Josiah tries to stop Egypt on the way, and he is killed by Pharaoh Necho II in a skirmish. Now, Pharaoh Necho, he could not help the Assyrian army overcome the Babylonians and the Medians and retake Haran. It was a humiliating loss, but it was a loss on both sides, a major loss. Therefore, Babylon couldn't follow up and make Egypt subservient. When Egypt was going back home through Palestine, she stopped off and besieged Jerusalem and put another king on the throne from Josiah's son. And so Pharaoh Necho, we think, took most of the treasures out of the house. You recently see the film, Raiders of the Lost Ark. And you may have wondered why that ark was in Egypt. Well, there is some good historical evidence that Pharaoh Necho took the Ark of the Covenant, not Nebuchadnezzar II of Babylon, and that movie has some historical base in Pharaoh Necho's coming through at this time. So that basically is where we are. The whole major power structure of the Fertile Crescent is changing. And that's what we're going to see. Now, beginning verse 28. Now the rest of the acts of Josiah and all he did, are they not written in the book of the Chronicles, the kings of Judah? In his days, Pharaoh Necho the second. Now I wish I had time to go back all through this. Pharaoh Necho the first is a puppet king put back on the throne by Assyria. But his son began to take control of Egypt again. And when Assyria got where she couldn't control her whole empire, he rebelled. Now the son of that next dynasty is Pharaoh Necho II, who we're dealing with. And he went up to the king of Assyria to the river Euphrates. Now look at your map, if you would. And we're going to be focusing in now on the map in just a moment. I want you to turn the back of your Bible, if you would, and you'll notice the headwater of the Euphrates. Now the Euphrates is, of course, the major river that forms the irrigation system known as the Fertile Crescent, the Tigris and Euphrates. Now the headwaters of that are in Syria, modern Syria. And so Pharaoh Necho left the Nile River Valley and moved up the Mediterranean coast to Megiddo, where he fought a minor skirmish with Josiah. And he was killed in a rather freak way. An arrow went through the armor and killed him, and he was probably the only one killed, and it was a tragedy. No one could understand. Let's go to the map a minute if we could, and you'll see someone like this in the back of your Bible. There's Megiddo. That orange area is the march of the Egyptian army, and Josiah tried to cut him off and couldn't. Now, if you keep going north, you'll find the headwaters to the Euphrates, and that's where Pharaoh Necho and the beaten up Assyrian army under Ashur-Uballit, and I said the wrong name a minute ago, forgive me, it's Ashur-Uballit, that's the current king of Assyria, that's going to fall miserably. Okay, now, all of this happened, let's see if we can put this together, and King Josiah went to meet him, and when Pharaoh Necho saw him, he killed him at Megiddo. 609 B.C. is probably the death of Josiah. And his servants, now this is Josiah, drove his body in his chariot, his royal chariot, from Megiddo, that's that famous place built by King Solomon for his chariots, and brought him to Jerusalem and buried him in his own tomb. Now Josiah is back with the kings of David, okay? And the people of the land took Jehoahaz, his son, and anointed him, made him king in his place. And Jehoahaz was 23 years old when he became king, and he reigned 3 months in Jerusalem, only 3 months. And he did evil in the sight of the Lord. And Pharaoh Necho II imprisoned him at Riblah, which is a city to the north, in the land of Hamath, that's to the north of the Sea of Galilee, that he might not reign in Jerusalem. And he imposed on the land a fine of 100 talents of silver and a talent of gold, a lot of money. And Pharaoh Necho made Eliakim, another son of Josiah, king, and changed his name to Jehoiakim. Now, Eliakim means God sets up, and Jehoiakim means Yahweh sets up. Now, the reason there's a J there, the first people to do word studies in the Old Testament were Germans, and there is no Y in German, so they changed all the Y sounds in Hebrew to J. And so there are no J's in Hebrew, okay? So it's Yahweh. Yahweh sets up. And he took Jehoahaz away and brought him to Egypt, and he died there. Now, Jehoiakim is a puppet king under Pharaoh Necho, and later he's going to become a puppet king under Babylon. It's amazing how many influence this poor king had on him. I think that's the end of this lesson. We're going to be in chapter 24 next week. We'll pick up where Babylon becomes the major world power. Again, there's so much history here. If you don't catch the flow, look at that set of maps in the back of your Bible. You'll see the major world power was first Assyria, and now it's going to be Babylon, and then it's going to be Persia, and then it's going to be Greece, and then it's going to be Rome. And if you can just see these major empires coming that influence the people of God, if you can just catch in your mind these enemies and put the Old Testament in the appropriate places, you'll have come a long way in understanding the Bible. I have a chart that shows all that I have mailed out to you. Look at those enemies across the top. If you don't have that chart or you'd like it, just write me and I'll send it to you. I've enjoyed being with you, and I'll see you again, same time, same place next week.